Wet kun waradu skatitzakos na yujets tanu wagenyahtu kanesadage nagenagere. Welcome everybody. This is a webinar to discuss the 1990 Kanehsatà siege and to talk about its impacts. We have some very special guests with us live from the golf course in Oka. So we want to say thank you, first of all, to the golf course administration for letting us use this spot. Behind me, you can see Hudson and the river, the Lake of Two Mountains. What we're going to do is start off with the introduction of our guests. And so what we're going to do, like, we're going to do the Mohawk way to my left, and they're going to introduce themselves to you. So to my left, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Paul Joff. I'm a lawyer specializing in international human rights law and Canadian constitutional law. And I'm based in Montreal, but we work with Indigenous peoples throughout Canada and different parts of the world.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Preston. I work for Canadian Friends Service Committee, which is the Quakers, and I work specifically on the file of Indigenous peoples, international human rights, and also work with Paul and with Ellen in the Coalition for the Human Rights of Indigenous Peoples.
Hi, my name is François Sayan. I'm an anti-poverty activist from Montreal, and I was a supporter of the Mohawks during the summer of 1990.
I'm an artist. I live in Montreal, and I was born in Kahnawà, and I'm happy to be here.
Segal, my name is Hannah Claus. I'm an artist as well. I'm going to be in the exhibition that Ellen Gabriel is putting together a little later this month, and I live in Montreal also.
My name is Marie David. I belong with the Bear Clan of the Haudenosaunee Confederacy. I'm from, born and raised in Kanehsatà, and I was working as a radio journalist for the community radio station in 1990.
Elizabeth Saka, a neighbor, a retired university professor, and a supporter of the community throughout the crisis.
My name is Julie Gaspé. I'm from Kanehsatà. I'm also an artist who will be taking part in the show coming up August 1st.
Wakaneradu. My name is Wanda Noro, Wanda Gabriel. I'm from Kanehsatà. And 25 years ago, I was involved in the liaison team bringing in food. As a result of my experience, I became a social worker specializing in healing trauma.
My name is Clifton Nicholas. I'm a filmmaker and was one of the young men who participated in the crisis in 1990. I also do a lot of speaking and academic circles and activist circles, and I guess I would be calling myself an activist in some regard. Yeah, we'll go.
Trant Nuskenaha, Sego. I'm Jolene Rickard from the Tuscarora Nation. I'm also an educator at Cornell University, and I'm here as both a collaborator and also in support of Indigenous rights.
So those of you who are live streaming and in your homes, you heard a clip by Marie David, who was just learning, and I don't know if you graduated journalism at the time. On March 8, 1990, the people of the community of Kanehsatà blocked a secondary dirt road to prevent the expansion of the nine-hole golf course and condominium development. For over close to 300 years now, our people have been dispossessed because of colonial laws, because of racist doctrines of superiority that claim sovereignty over our lands and our resources. But in 1990, the community got together and we drew a line and we said, no more. We are going to unite and stop the theft of our lands. And so that's exactly what we did. There were three injunctions against between March 8th and July 11th. July 9th, the third injunction expired. On the morning of July 11th at 5:15 in the morning, while we were burning tobacco, the police arrived, a SWAT or a paramilitary force arrived in Kanehsatà at the front barricades. The women, 14 women and young women, went to the front, and we spoke with the police three times. They tried to discourage us by throwing tear gas and concussion grenades at us, and the wind blew it and took it back to them. But the third time it did. But the women agreed during that time before the crisis happened that we would go to the front when the police arrived, because it is the duty of the women to protect the land, as it is the duty of the men to protect the people. And so I want to be clear, after 25 years, none of us did anything wrong. We were totally within our rights to protect the people, to protect the land. After 25 years, we have lost even more land to more colonial laws like the Kanehsatà Land Management Act. The condominiums have moved to the outskirts of what is called Oka, but Oka is Kanehsatà. It is the colonial imposed name upon our traditional territory. And Kanehsatà existed long before Europeans arrived here. Kanehsatà is the condolence of the chiefs, because we are the oldest community and we speak the oldest dialect. So I just want to put that into context for you about what was going on. And I really want to say that, I mean no disrespect, the media made it about the warriors, and it was not about the warriors with the guns. It was about the people behind the barricades trying to live an existence surrounded and outnumbered and outgunned by the military of Canada, by the Sûreté du Québec. And so the whole community was under siege, and our sister community in Kahnawà on July 11th, the Mercier Bridge, in support of the people here in Kanehsatà to prevent a second wave and to prevent a massacre. So Nyako to our sisters and brothers, Kahnawà Kehronu, thank you. I think they're doing something this morning on the Mercier Bridge. And if you could pass the mic to Marie. What we're going to do is ask Marie David how she felt, what was she seeing, you know, like what was going on when you arrived in the Pines. You know, I think you arrived after three times we had gone to the front, and so you didn't see that part. Yeah. But it was filled with tear gas, so please tell your story.
Yeah, when I at the camp, their barricade, and they were lining the road, and I didn't know what to expect when I got on our side. But what I saw was people who were really calm, making breakfast, and just maybe a little bit in shock, too. And so I just went about my job, even though I was a volunteer, it was my job to do interviews and try to get tape, archival tape for our community. I didn't know, none of us really knew, I don't think, what was actually going to transpire. But my important strategy was to get everything on tape that I could. Like I said, people were calm. They were making breakfast, and they weren't nervous. You know what I mean? And then around 8:30. That's when they started to come in, and well, I think they heard it on the tape. So I don't know what else to say.
Well, what I've heard the tape, and like I hear even in my voice the tension and the fear, like afterwards. But yeah. People were like on automatic, right?
Yeah. I think they were a little bit in shock. The kids had already been moved out. The children that were there when they arrived first thing in the morning, they had been moved out. Mm-hmm. But what was there was the women and some unarmed men. And, they were on automatic pilot, basically. Mm-hmm. Still trying to communicate to say, look, you can take the barricade down, but we're not going to leave. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't really confrontational on our side.
Mm-hmm. Were you aware of what was going on the outskirts when they were burning the tires and what was going on in the village? Were you aware of that?
Well, when I first arrived, I tried to come in on Route 344, and they had a barricade. The police had a barricade set up just maybe a mile down the road, so I couldn't come in that way. Mm-hmm. I had to go around and come in the back way. And JAD arrived, and they had their radio blaring, so we could hear what was going on outside the area, like in the village and stuff. And it sounded like there was a big buildup of police presence. But we couldn't, and we heard that there was something going on in Kanehsatà, but I don't think they had blocked the bridge yet at that time.
Well, that was, I think it's one of the most powerful pieces recorded of July 11th of that summer, and it was the beginning of the 78-day crisis, which for us never really finished.
Yeah.
I want to talk to Wanda, because Wanda was the army liaison when the army finally moved in September, in August. The army, they did not do the country proud in the disrespectful way that they treated the women and the lewd gestures they were making towards us and in just their attitude. So can you tell me a little bit about what your experiences were as an army liaison for the community?
Well, good morning, everybody. And I think, 25 years, here we are 25 years later, and there's some, I have many memories of that time behind the barricades. And a lot of the memories are shadows of what happened. My experience as one of the, I was one of the liaison team members for working with the Army and the Sûreté du Québec and the international observers. There was Willie Nelson and Chiki Etienne, Debbie Etienne, who were also a part of the team. And it's, when you're dealing with crisis, it's interesting how these things get assigned. I was walking into the food bank one day, and I think Willie or Chiki came up to me and said, "Do you want to be part of the liaison team?" And 30-year-old here, had no experience. I'm an at-home mom with four kids, and sure, I'll be part of the liaison team, but not really understanding fully what I was getting into. But knowing what for me, what was really important was that we needed to, and the torture that was the SQ and the Army towards our people, and for me to get involved, that was the most important thing, because hearing the stories and seeing the consequences of the interactions between the police and the Army, seeing people who had cigarette burns on them, people who had got beaten up by Army or SQ, and for me, I wanted us to document it, I wanted it to be acknowledged, I wanted it to stop. And the people from all over were sending us food, because to get through a six-kilometer ride from our home to the village to buy food was, I remember the first time out, I went out with my four kids. Then they were aged 10 to 3. I went out alone with them and to go to the grocery store, and I got pulled out of the car, gunpoint, all me and all my kids. And it took us like 6 hours to go to the village through all those barricades to get food. So people stopped going out and getting food. And so for me, it was, we have a right to food. We have a right to spiritual support. And I really wanted to be involved for that. So working with the Army as liaison, I thought, okay, so we're going to have some people who are really interested in helping us get food and spiritual support and to stop the abuses. And naively at the time, in talking with Colonel Degg at the time, Colonel Degg, I thought that, what we were asking, I thought it was being respected and I thought it was being honored. But I felt that, we made arrangements, okay, such and such a load of food is going to come in. And it never did. It would sit on the road for hours and go to waste, fresh produce sitting in the sun and, heat like we've been having, 30 Celsius with high humidity, and the food goes bad and the road sitting on the road so the food doesn't come in. And after we've had this discussion, the liaison team, okay, food's going to come in easily. And it didn't happen.
You're talking about the Army and the SQ, right?
Army and the SQ, yeah.
They're the ones making the meat spoil in the hot
sun.
Yeah,
the Army and the SQ would say, you know, they're people who run as liaisons and said, okay, no problem, Madame Gabrielle, the food's going to come in, it's going to go to the food bank, we won't be holding it. And they'd end up holding it. So, you know, they're lied to our faces. And, you know, I was there and the other members were there. We were believing that this was a sincere and people of integrity through and, you know, talking about people who are getting beaten up by the Army or the SQ and, oh, no, c'est arrive pas ça, madame. But it was because, you know, I saw it with my eyes and then they would say, no, it's not happening. So, you know, I was always astounded at these people in this position of power can be lying to my face like this and to manipulate what we know. And I remember when the day the army moved up on Asinasu, I was there and Colonel Daig was there and it was this really high intense moment with the people here in the community. The liaison person, I'm a nobody. I'm just a Colonel Daig says, well, Madame Gabriel gave me permission to move in. Like, who am I to do that?
They were liars. Can we show us an image from an image for the people live streaming? Yeah, I mean, there are thousands, if not millions, of stories of people in Canada, but here in the community, hundreds of stories, different stories. And, you know, we didn't say thank you to you for doing that, for doing such a great job, and Sonia Okoa, and Nyawa Marie for recording this, you know, for future generations. They're going to be learning from things that you do. So Nyawa. I'd like to start now with Clifton Nicholas, who was one of the young men who was on the front lines. Nyawa Wanda.
Segues. Yeah, I always say whenever I talk about 1990, I talk about it being a pivot point in my life. There was life before and life after. Very young, idealistic, young boy of 18, you know, a boy, and I emphasize the word boy because that's what I was. Being pretty much thrust into this stage and having a mixed bag of emotions throughout the summer, you know, adventure, excitement being what some of those feelings. Fear after the shootout, fear and a lot of trepidation. What's next? What's next? When's the other shoe going to fall? And for 25 years, still waiting for the other shoe to fall. Even to this day, you know, it's still not as bad as it was in the first, say, 6 years after the crisis. But during that summer, I remember having such anxiety and anger at what was going on in the community. Anger at what was going on around us, hearing the stories, you know, you talk about people being beaten. My late stepfather, Angus Jacob, I remember after he got out of the hands of the SQ, he was so badly beaten, his face was all swelled up. And I remember him sitting there and his testicles were literally the size of oranges. And he had bruises on the inside of his thighs when they were kicking him. His ribs were bruised. He couldn't eat. All he could do was sit there and just in so much pain. And that man never got over that. You know, he never got over that. And I found that his alcoholism got worse afterwards. And this big fear when it came to dealing with the police. And, you know, like, I had a lot of that fear, too, after 1990 when I would travel out. And I remember getting pulled over all the time. I never left this community in 1990. I never made it into the treatment center, but I never left because... Because of what happened to Angus, what happened to my cousin Danielle, also, who was burnt with cigarettes. They tortured him, they beat him, they burnt him on his stomach with cigarettes. Pulled big chunks of his hair out of his head. One of many people who were caught and beaten like that. I'm deathly proud of what we did in 1990. Because when I walked through Onondaga, when I was just there this morning, we were burning tobacco. And I said, you know, our testament are the trees that are still there. You know, when I go to the cemetery and I visit my ancestors over there, they're still interred over there. A lot over it. You know, I think back on a lot of things that happened during that summer and a lot of things that it affected afterwards. At the time, wasn't too sure about about what it was. I knew it was a big thing, but I had no idea the global impact and the global reach that it had until I went to Greece. I remember I was in Greece and I was about to speak, and this guy came out of the crowd, pulled off his shirt, and he had a warrior flag tattooed from shoulder to shoulder. Couldn't speak a word of English. I was like, Indianos, Indianos. He's like shaking my hand, right? So happy that I was there to talk about what's happening in 1990 and what's happening in indigenous circles today. But yeah, it was quite it's quite an interesting thing, life-altering to say the least, and I'm sure I'm not the only one that could say life-altering. We all had experiences in 1990 from what we lived here in the woods. What we had in the negotiation teams and what people were living in the village also. There was all different stories that had to be shared. And I think they're all valid, like working on my film right now about this stuff too. And it's part of it's opening some wounds too, and part of it's getting past those things. And 25 years later, I have to put these things in a way where they need to be put away.
Now, Clifton, that was Clifton Nicholas recounting, and I know some of you are live tweeting some of the quotes. The young woman who was spoken before Clifton was Wanda Gabriel. You listened and opened up this live webinar with work done by Marie David on July 11th for the raid. And I, you know, it's a scar that doesn't go away. It's like a big scar. And it's a mental scar, the kind of trauma that we all experienced on today, this very day. And it doesn't go away. It kind of, you know, just like any scar, it'll fade a little bit. But it's still very fresh. And I want to talk to Julie Gaspy, who's going to be an artist. I'm Jolene Rickard and myself are organizing an art show August 1st to the 12th here at the School in the Pines, to talk about what the impacts were on art and culture. And Julie is one of the artists, and she did a wonderful piece just before. It's almost like a prophetic piece about the pines. And Julie and her family, like some of my relatives and aunties and my sister, they were in the village living behind the SQ barricades just down the hill from here. So Julie, do you want to talk a little bit about what life was like behind the SQ barricades?
Yeah, sure. As some of you may know or may not know, but I'll put into perspective how our territory works. Most of the land base is based up what we call Center Road up the bay. But in the village, we have land that is still Mohawk territory. There's 69 properties that are still part of our territory where we live. And, you know, you always have to wonder how come the rest of the village is not like that. But through all the colonial and Sulpicians taking our land away, this is what happened. But most the people who are living in the village still hold on to their land very dear. But that morning of July 11th, 1990, it was much a day like today, beautiful blue sky. My family, we would come up to the barricade that was up here, my mother and my sister, before the crisis happened. We would come and man the barricade, I guess you would say. And that morning, we were sleeping on the porch, because every morning we'd go up there. And we heard all the commotion. We heard on the radio that things were happening. So we got up real quick and we came down to the bottom of the hill with our intention of coming up. I'll come to help out. We were stopped down here by the SQ. They had their barricades up already. By then, many other people had started gathering and trying to go up the hill, but of course we weren't allowed. We could hear the commotion. We could hear shouting. We could hear noises that we didn't know. We did get a cloud of tear gas come down the hill and affect us. I know me and my friend, we went behind the hardware store and our eyes were all burning and we're imagining what was happening up here. We didn't know. We didn't know anything that was going on.
What was it like, sorry, when you heard the gunfire? How did the people react that were down there?
We were in shock. we could hear the gunfire, and we were saying, oh my God, they're all dead. We thought all our people were dead. Mm-hmm. That's what was going through our mind. We didn't know. Everyone was talking, and people were listening to radios, and they're trying to find out what happened. We had the SQ blocking us. They had, a van come by, we thought, with extra people. We didn't know what was in their van, but we stopped them, and we started shaking the van. We didn't let them go up. Then we saw the ambulance come down. We had no clue who was in there. And they let the ambulance through, and I think by that point everything was going so fast and things were happening, and I think the SQ themselves didn't know what was happening. 'Cause after that, people dispersed, and I remember coming up through Center Road to come see what had happened. By then, we had found out that none of our people were hurt, and that unfortunately a SQ officer had been shot. And so we came up behind the barricade, and that's when our people had put up the barricade here on Route 344 with all the police cars all crushed and all that.
Where did you witness them putting it all?
No, we were just at the tail end, but we saw all the destruction. We were picking up pieces of police car, pieces of memorabilia. So it was crazy, and like you said, there was a tire fire burning at the other end. There was roads blocked off up the bay, and that's when we knew that there was this could take a while. But we were so glad to know that none of our people had gotten injured physically.
We have 8 minutes left in our section of for Kanehsatà. Just really quickly, what do you see as part of the healing process? What was it like for you? And I know that's really that's a crazy time limit to have for healing, but if you want to talk or if you don't want to talk, that's fine too. So if since Julie still has the mic, we'll go this way, and then maybe Marie will end with you. So Wanda, then Clifton.
I think part of my healing was to know that so many people supported us, Native, non-Native people coming together. Before that, Oka or Kanehsatà was not even on the map. And after that, everyone knew where we were from, and we were so supported by all these people across the
Yeah, with Julie. It's Wanda Gabriel.
Wanda Gabriel. I think for me, the healing part, there's many levels to it. For me, though, being behind the barricades and being part of standing up, part of resistance, was to be awakened, that I'm no longer a victim. And a victim, I'm talking about a victim of colonization and oppression. You see, at the time, I did not know I was a victim of colonization and oppression. I thought the hard stuff going around in my community was because of something wrong with my family, something wrong with my people. But what I understand in my healing journey is to understand that colonization and oppression have caused a lot of damage to our people and continues to cause a lot of damage to our people. And so for me, in my journey of healing, is to understand colonization and oppression, to understand spirituality, to take a spiritual path. And in that spiritual path is to find forgiveness, or work towards forgiveness, and to enlarge our understanding between our people and the people down the hill and the people across the water, and to have a dialogue. So for me, being able to get out of my comfort zone, get out of my victimitis, and to be able to have a conversation, to be able to have a dialogue. And what I'm coming up with now is that, you know, a lot of things we've been labeled, our people have been labeled a lot of things, with this syndrome and that syndrome. And in the work that I do, in the healing work that I do, I'm beginning to see that there's a colonizer's syndrome, a settler syndrome. So I'm going to be writing about that soon, so that we can better understand each other, so we can help each other. It's not just us with a syndrome.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's it. Nyao koa.
Nyao wanda.
Yeah, I have to agree with you on that settler syndrome part.
Yeah.
Been dealing with that for many years. Like Wanda, it's a process. One single thing, been a multiple amount of things. I mean, getting over it. And for myself, at this moment now, like I mentioned earlier, I'm working on a film. It's introspective about my feelings, and it's helping me move forward. I mean, having wonderful people in my circle like yourself, Ellen, you know, helps me get past certain things, helps me heal, helps me understand things. Working with my activist friends in the activist communities in Montreal and around, you know, that helps me also. Meeting people like Francine LeMay, it was helpful for me to get past a certain point also. And helping her maybe get past some things also. You know, all these things are so important to moving forward, you know, as I get older, getting older in passage, you know, as a man, you know, my testosterone levels are decreasing. My hair is getting whiter. My edges are softening a bit. I mean, the mind is still kind of sharp. But I kind of feel glad getting older because, damn, that testosterone, isn't that ever something to deal with, you know? Can really make us do some stupid things. But yeah, I feel a lot more in control of my feelings right now. And understanding, like you said, through a lot of introspection, a lot of examination, and a lot of reading, you know, our histories and finding out where things are, right? And I was mentioning just the other day that, you know, you have to continue teaching people what happened in 1990. I wish people would have taught me what happened in the 1870s in this community, which was a precursor to 1990. You know, we are victims to repeat things if we don't learn about them.
Exactly.
And it's always been one of my things to help myself, it's a selfish reason, to go and teach and discuss it in public circles, at universities and schools. Anytime I'm asked, you know, I always do. Nyao koa.
Nyao Clifton. So we're going to end with Marie. This is Marie David, everyone.
Okay. I just want to agree with all of that, what everybody... I too, like with Julie, during the summer, what part of our healing, my healing, was knowing that there was so much support out there for us, and keeping the government in check, trying to anyway. And also, being in the pines is healing, 'cause it's a very spiritual place, and coming there and getting the energy back that we need has been very healing. And also recognizing that for myself, that I had PTSD and that I needed counseling. And, you know, it's a step. We didn't know that much about PTSD back then.
Mm-hmm.
And we've learned a lot. And it's unfortunate that some people didn't get the counseling they needed. And if they still suffer from it, they should get it.
Nyao to all of you for sharing your stories, and it's not an easy thing to talk about, because it is, once you start the road to healing, it's like an onion peel, right? There's other issues that start coming up. So Jolene, I don't know if you have some questions or want to just have sort of like a analysis of what's been said so far.
The only thing I was reflecting on is what an honor it is to be here with you, because I think that for many of us, you represent the struggle that I think we're all engaged in as Indigenous peoples. And it's a struggle conceptually for many Indigenous peoples, but with this experience, it became the reality of what colonization continues to be in the Americas, and as many of us are now exploring globally. And so this isn't a condition that is ended, and this was a flashpoint. And it's I think that your point about us knowing our history is really significant. Well, at the same time, the work that it takes to continually overcome these structures, I think is really what you're teaching us with this. And that's why I think it's important that we gather today, because we have to remind ourselves that we can never be complacent in our relationship to our to place. For us to continue to be who we are, we do have these profound relationships to place, and you stood that ground, and it's just a reminder for us all.
Yawa, Jolene. And I want to say sago to all the allies who are here. Hopefully some of you are watching live streaming right now. Nyoko, the community still thinks of you. We still are grateful for you coming to our aid. To all the people who donated food, the Native Friendship Center of Montreal, Quebec Native Women, the community of Six Nations, all the Quebecois people who supported us. And we'll have some of those reflections. Up the golf course lawn, for those of you who are just joining us. Behind me in the river is Hudson. And I had an order, but I started thinking after listening to my friends and cousins here that I would like to go to Pierre Lepage. Pierre Lepage is a former human rights advocate with the Quebec Human Rights. Pierre saw the buildup and the tension before the crisis happened. So I'm wondering if Pierre, you would like to talk a little bit about your experiences and how that was for you, and what did you witness?
Thank you to invite me, Sego, first. I will need some help, but because my English is not good. The first time I came here was in 1986. At the beginning of the project of treatment center, and I saw at this moment that the conflict on the land was with the government, federal government. Après racine peut-être. Roots at the local level with the municipality, and we saw the creation of the Regroupement des Citoyens d'Oka. There was a petition against the treatment center, and after that, each time that the Mohawk community had the project, the municipality of Oka had the Règlement Municipal. And we saw the blessures accumulate, game here at the local level and the regional level. Okay. And as Human Rights Commission, we look at the situation of relation between police and Native communities. More than 1 year before the crisis, the commission, there was at Chibougamau, Quebec, a meeting of chiefs across Canada to sign a treaty concerning the police, opération policière in Native community. We were very anxious, worry of that. And in Kahnawà, the Quebec Human Rights Commission asked the Ministre de la Sécurité Publique at this moment not to to intervene there because the bingo. We knew that the Band Council and the Mohawk Nation Office told that they was to work together against police raid in their community, and it was very dangerous. And the Human Rights Commission received many complaints from Native communities concerning the police raids in communities, massive raids, who were not supposed to but all the community was in the affect by these raids. It's why the Quebec Human Rights Commission, it's a few months before the beginning of the crisis, asked the government of Quebec to have the funds, the money, to make public hearings concerning the relation between police and Native communities. We had complaints from the Eskoumé, from Lac Barrière, from Kanehsatà, from Kahnawà, and others. There was a big problem of relation between Sûreté du Québec and the peacekeepers, between Sûreté du Québec and police amérindienne in other communities. And 1 month before the crisis, the chief of the Assembly of First Nations deposited a petition at the National Assembly asking the government of Quebec to give to the commission the money to have these public hearings and to try to find solutions.
Pierre, could you talk about the report, because we have 2 minutes left for you, okay. And then we're going to move to
about Thompson. The report on
at the end of the crisis, like what were the conclusions that the Quebec Human Rights...
Okay, yes. But I am one of the writers of the shock collective, collective shock, with the report of the Quebec Human Rights Commission, and it was at the coroner's inquest too, on the death of the Caporal Lemay. There was a... We were here before, during the crisis, and after. And during the crisis, we were here because there was a food bank. They stopped, the police stopped Indians to bring inside the community.
Did you witness any of those violations?
Yes. In the report of the Quebec Human Rights Commission, yes. And we asked the Ministère de la Sécurité Publique to stop this food blockage, to block the foods. There was a discriminatory... The blockade was discriminatory. The non-Indians, it was possible for non-Indian to bring some food inside the Kanehsatà, but not for Indians, and we had other examples. But a few days in the report, you see that a few days before the 11th July, I was in the Pines to make a proposal of the commission, for the commission. The commission is there to apply a law, the Quebec Charter of Human Charter of Human Rights and Freedoms in Quebec, but it was impossible for me to tell to the Mohawks not to respect an order of the tribunal. And it's why the solution we saw was to, if you have to quit the barricades, it is not because you don't want to défier l'ordre du tribunal, but because you are open to the proposal of the commission. We propose that the conflict was submit to a committee, independent committee, Mohawks and non-Mohawks on this committee, to look at all the situation of the lands and the land claims on La Seigneurie du Lac des Deux Montagnes. And in the Pines, it was, I think that the people who was there was open to this I stopped there. So.
Well, I thank you very much. I think you played a key role in witnessing being one of the first human rights groups that witnessed the violations that were happening before, during, and after. So we really say Nyankowa, thank you to the Quebec Human Rights, yourself and your colleague Paul Sainte-Marie. Yes, I remember you both very, very well. Thank you very much, Pierre. I'm wondering if Francine, if you would be comfortable to talk for a few minutes. Francine Lemay is a translator, and she has become
a semi-retired
translator. She has become a great friend and ally, a true symbol of reconciliation. Unfortunately, her brother was the one that passed away and lost his life because of the golf course expansion on that day. And Francine translated our history book, At the Wood's Edge, which has documented all the history of our community. And Francine translated it into French so that our fellow Québécois can also have an opportunity to understand the history. So, Francine, I'm not going to ask you any questions. I'm just going to say whatever you want to express for us today on this anniversary. Please feel free.
First, thank you for inviting me. Yes. I feel part of you. We have something in common. We have scars. Mm-hmm. I've got scars on my knee. Mm-hmm. It reminds me of the patin à roulette.
Yes.
Rollerblade when I was a little girl, but mm-hmm. 25 years ago, you had suffered, I have suffered. Mm-hmm. We all have scars, but I decided before this year, I decided not to dwell on the past, on my scars. I want the past to serve us as a tremplin, mm-hmm. to learn lessons. I heard some words said by Billy Graham 50 years ago. He said, First Nation are a sleeping giant who's about to wake up. He said that 50 years ago. Mm-hmm. And it made me think, why sleeping? Well, I know he was sleeping because he was anesthésié, étouffé, by government and politician, but it's waking up in a good sense. I was watching last night on APTM, Indian Life, the movie about the Oka Crisis. They showed just part of it. And when the actor of my brother was on the ground, it reminded me it happened. Mm-hmm. But when I saw the other stuff after, some of the you have mentioned, mm-hmm. the abuse done by the SQ, I was thinking, how can that happen? People don't know about that. Yes. So we suffer on both sides.
Yes.
But I think a lot of those abuse have been done in revenge, mm-hmm. out of anger. But Jesus says to forgive. Pardonnez à ceux qui. Pardonnez à tout le monde. You talked about reconciliation, about forgiveness, and we need forgiveness on both sides. Je me rappelle aussi les paroles de Jésus qui dit heureux ceux qui procurent la paix. In English, they say peacemaker. And in the word peacemaker, procure la paix, it's not only a wish, a desire, it's a verb of action. And I think we are making something today. We're not just wishing peace. We want to be artisans de la paix, peacemaker. How? By building bridges. I have a friend who's an engineer, and he said building a bridge is much, much harder than building a wall. And I don't want to destroy walls of indifference. Mipri, hate. And I want to build with the good material, not the one that they use for Bridge Champlain, because I heard that they didn't use the right kind of cement to save money. I want to use a good material with you. It's not you and me, it's us.
Exactly. Together we forge that bridge together, yes. So that yes. These kinds of events don't happen again.
Yes. And mentality of people is changing. I see it.
I think it's owed to people like you who lead the way in reconciliation, in your openness, your kindness, your love, your compassion. And so we are very grateful that you are with us today.
I'm grateful to Gabriel and Arlette who wrote the book, because it's yes. that book who really opened my eyes mm-hmm. to a reality that Quebecers don't know. I even met some more that who don't know their own history.
this book, I don't know if we can zoom in on the book. It's it was 5 years of research, and when we publicized, we had a media event. Not a single media outlet showed up. Not one. So something positive like this, that is the history of the community of Kanehsatà, and you can get it online at mohawklanguagecustodians.com or .ca. You can order the book. It's about the history. It's also in French, thanks to Francine. À l'oreille des bois. Yes, à
l'oreille des bois. And a lot of people who read that book told me personally it changed their way of thinking, that just like me, they didn't know anything about the history of the
war. And this is what this is about. This is to make sure that the narrative that's been spun by the media is going to change after 25
gradually.
Years, and we're going to show the real history of why
yes.
Indigenous people are always fighting against government. Mm-hmm. And so I thank you, Francine, for being with us and sharing your moving story. We are so honored to have you here with us, Francine.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have, as I said, we have some really wonderful guests. I don't know if any of you are who are live streaming are seeing the images, if we can show some of the images. But I'd like to move on to next, and this is really talking about the impacts. This is a poster for an art show August 1st to the 12th here at Arunhyadeka School here in the Pines in Kanehsatà. And it's really to talk about how this particular event has impacted artists, whether it's in their lives, activism, or in their work. So I'd like to start off with some of the artists who have kindly donated their thing. And who are part of the show. There are 14 artists, I think, or 17 artists, who are part of the show. And one of them is Hannah Claus. She's going to talk to you about what she sees as the impact of art on by the crisis, the siege.
Hi. Well, my name is Hannah Claus. I'm a visual artist living in Montreal. I haven't always lived here. I've lived here for the past sort of 14 years, but the conflict with Kanehsatà and Oka was certainly one of the first major issues that I was aware of. And how did it impact me? It's something where it really made me come to terms with my identity. I grew up knowing that I was of Mohawk heritage, as well as obviously Euro-Canadian, but not really knowing what that meant. I grew up very far away from my community, and from any community, any Mohawk community. So it's something that I wanted to find out more. I knew the media image of what was being presented, and wanted to see more of what that was. The other side of the media image. That image of the warrior, the image of the confrontation between the warrior and the SQ. So I guess that came up in my work with an installation I did and sort of research about the motivations for fighting, for protesting, for taking a stake, a claim to protect the land and the families. And that's what my piece is about in the show that Alan is going to do. In my work in general, it is looking at the layering of identity, the many layers that go into making up who we are, and how things are not necessarily black and white, but different layers of gray and transparency.
Could you speak a little closer? Because I have a hard time hearing. But how did you see the impact? Like, did it change you right away? Like, where were you on this day 25 years ago?
Well, for me particularly, I wasn't yet on that journey as an artist. I was somewhere else doing a university degree, and it was something that was visceral, where I saw this in the news, what was happening. Like I said, it was the first time I really saw that this issue coming up as indigenous rights and problems and identities due to colonialism. It was the first real contact I had with it, but it was through the media. I wasn't connected to this community. I wasn't living near Montreal, and I think it's something, just those media images stayed with me and sunk in about wanting to find out what was beyond the media image. Mm-hmm. What else, what was the real story, the other perspectives to the story that wasn't being shown by the media really. So thank you.
And so what kind of work do you make, Hannah? Just if you just tell us a little bit about how you see your practice relating to creating this space of awareness.
Well, my work, I do installations, so it's something that's very process-based. It takes a lot of time. I think it's the connecting with the process that helps me work through ideas. And it's about transforming a space. I want to create places that people can walk into to experience the work and my ideas. The work itself is often relating to identity, though it might not be immediately obvious at first when you see it. But for example, I've done work that is using clouds, suspended elements of clouds that are made up of thousands and thousands of translucent discs, and it relates to the creation story, the creation teaching of Sky Woman and Sky World. That's just sort of one example of something I've done. So,
Nyawa, I think we're going to ask Kahnawà now to pick up the discussion. okay. All right. Kahnawà has been working in digital and media arts and has made work directly about this experience. And so I'm hoping that you can share your thoughts and courage, actually, to try to take this experience on and represent it.
Well, Nyawa Goa, for using that word, courage, I appreciate it. The work that Jolene is talking about is called Time Traveler TM. It's a machinima. A machinima is a new word for a lot of people, but it's basically a movie made in a virtual environment. And so in my I have a story about a Mohawk man who lives in the future. And in the future, there is a technology that kind of looks like glasses, and when you put on these glasses, you can visit an historical event. And my character, his name is Hunter. He travels to various historical events, and of course one of them is the crisis. And he doesn't know that much about himself. Hunter doesn't know that much about his own history. This is why he's doing this. And it was very obvious to me that this was a very important historical event that needed to be shown in my movie, which has about 9 historical events that he goes to. I always think that it could be a never-ending series because there are so many important historical events that need to be told from our perspective. I think that's the main thing I was trying to do, is to show our side of the story, perhaps. Well, not perhaps, but certainly a different point of view than I think most people saw, especially given the media coverage of the event.
I think it's especially powerful that you shifted our way of engaging this experience from the photograph to the virtual. And I was wondering what you think, how you think that operates, because so much of this experience has been located in a very narrow band of images that are directly related to confrontation, and you took a very different tact with this. So I'm wondering if you could just open that up a little.
I think I'll want you to respond a bit to what I say, because I'd like to know more of what you're thinking. But certainly, so the reason I use the virtual as a material is because I think it represents the future. I think it's a great way for us to think about ourselves in the future, and I don't see Native people in the future very often. So I wanted, first of all, to put us there, reminding ourselves that we're going to be there and helping other people. You know, I think that's one of our jobs as an artist, right, is to provide imagery to help us all collectively visualize something. And so the future was a kind of important thing for us to visualize, especially given our, I think, being told constantly that we are not going to be existing in the future, that we exist in the past and we're an anomaly. The fact that we exist right now is like crazy, you know. And so I wanted to say, no, not really. We plan to be there in the future, and this is how I want to show it. So that was one big reason for the virtual. Yeah, what were you thinking? I mean, the difference between the photograph and the virtual, that's for me mainly what it is. It's taking it out of the present and putting it into the future.
Right. Well, I think that does allow us, there are, I think, a couple milestones with this. And that one, that the Oka Crisis became one of the most visual presence of indigenous peoples in the 20th century. It was the second marker from in the United States when Wounded Knee occurred in 1973. And so this event then became picked up by the media, and the way in which the media engaged it, of course, was through primarily through image making. And so for you to kind of take that back and reclaim it as a space, I think was really about, I think it's really about this kind of, it certainly is a form of empowerment, but at the same time, I think it's opening up another way to reinscribe our presence, because the process of an animation does allow for one to imagine. It's like a co-imagining versus very fixed images that have been created by media and photography. And so that's, I guess, what I was engaged with in your piece. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think that Hunter, just the language, the figure that you use, gives people an opportunity to speak back to this the trope of the Mohawk warrior and the way in which you moved this figure. And I'm just wondering, because in some ways, do you reinstall the figure, or is that something that you thought about, or is it something that you wanted to, like this strong presence, this strong, very strong male presence in that figure?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I wanted him to be, Hunter's a number of people in my life. So he's not just, he's in fact almost not at all a Mohawk warrior stereotype.
Yeah.
I wanted him to be handsome. And I wanted him to be.
And Mohawk warriors are not handsome, is that?
You know, I think you're beautiful. And I wanted him to be all these various things, and that was just the first word on the list. I did want him to be kind of quite
manly, strong, you know, those things. So all these, what I'm trying to get at is one part of him is this type A male that I wanted him to be. But then I also wanted him to be extremely intelligent and insightful, which is not maybe always ascribed to a bulky guy like that. And then I also want him to be very respectful of women. You know, I mean, and again, like I said, this is reflecting the men that I've been lucky enough to know in my life, the, you know, especially the Mohawk men, but all of the men,
right.
My dad too, who's an Italian guy, right? I wanted to tell the story of where I was on the date of July 11th, if I could fast forward or flash it back, because I was in Italy. I was at a drawing class offered by Concordia, and also though I was going to seek out my Italian heritage while I was there, and I did do that,
mm-hmm.
but it was interesting because I think it was probably not July 11th, but maybe the soon after that I called home, which I did very periodic, you know, each week or so. I was on a, it was a long trip, I can't remember exactly how long the class was. And I'm talking to my mom, and she says, they blocked the bridge. I said, what? And of course we remembered that they had blocked the bridge just a couple of years earlier, because Kanehsatà was raided by the police. And I said, and she said, it's really bad, it's really tense. I said, should I come home? She goes, oh, no, it's only going to be about 3 days. They'll be back, everything will be back to normal in a couple of days, which, of course, was not the case.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my little story.
And so how can people find your work? Just look your name up? And
well, I think you can probably look up Skawanati, which is a little hard to spell. But timetravelertm.com is the website.
Okay.
Time Traveler is spelled TimeTraveler.com.
Great.
Thank you.
And so we'd like to ask Julie to share something about her work with us.
Yeah, I was a young lady at the time. I was 21 years old. And I would just finish my first year of fine arts at Concordia University. And for our last project in our drawing class, I decided to do this drawing that really would shed light on what was happening here. Because, of course, the crisis, as it's known to be, it did not start July 11th. It was months before that where we had... stuff going on in the community. And so what I had imagined was the worst that could happen here in Kanehsatà, and of course it was centered around the lacrosse box. So I drew that first, and then I imagined the two armies coming together. What I call the non-native armies and the native people all coming together in this battle at our lacrosse field. And I used the images of like the old Western type cowboys and Indians. I used the old when the Champlain days, when the armies of the French and the English came together, and all of them were on one side, and then all the different nations of the Native Americans on one side. And I never really expected anything like that to happen, and it seemed like it did. I also have a lot of our spiritual guides, I guess, and protectors in the trees above us. That's what I saw when I was, I didn't intend to start with that, but that's what came out in the drawing. And I believe they were there that day. They were there helping us during all the conflict that happened. So it was kind of, I wanted to bring light to my classmates of what we were going through. And it sure did start a discussion in our class, and I realized then how opinionated people could be on a subject they didn't know very much about. So I was glad to shed light on that with my drawing, and I had never done that before, so I was quite proud of myself.
Awesome. Thank you, Julie. Elizabeth, this is Dr. Elizabeth Saka. She's also part of the Onehkwéntara Kanehstóte art show. Elizabeth has been a friend and ally for many years since the crisis, and so it's a great honor to have you here with us, Elizabeth.
Oh, it's a privilege and honor to be here. And following Julie, my work really represents, in a way, the conflagration I was afraid, further deaths, more chaos than at the beginning of the crisis. And that was on my mind all through the crisis, a possible maelstrom. But my story basically starts 32 years ago when we were on a camping trip, my partner and I, camping and bicycling, and it seemed that he had gotten food poisoning. But the food poisoning got worse, and it went on for days. He lost 40-some pounds and was pretty much close to death. And one doctor treated him and said he was poisoned from the chemicals he worked with, and that he had to move out of the city and away from city pollution, or he would never get better. So we started a search all around the city of Montreal to find a clean place where he could survive, and we came across the pines. And this region, which we found, he seemed to feel better in this area. We looked at pollution charts, etc., and decided to try to settle in this quadrant of Quebec. And we did find a house that was mostly it was all natural materials with large trees, etc. And that's been a big factor in his recovery. But we did discover the top pines at that time, and I felt very reassured by the pines and very comforted and always safe in the pines, and I would return here to draw. And so eventually, 7 years later, people were standing across the dirt track there in the pines to keep developers from coming in, and I talked to a few of them, and they told me about the grandparents and great-grandparents who had protected the pines from development, and I could see why this natural place continued to exist, and I also began to learn about a culture that really prioritizes nature, respect for nature, respect for all living things. So from that point forward, then a month later, the raid happened. And I was just shocked and stunned at the force of the SQ against the people. I am still shaken by that. And at the same time, throughout the crisis, what I saw was an amassing of a huge number of people beginning to talk about the issues, beginning to understand that something else was going on here that the outsiders didn't understand and we needed to know about. So I was around the fringes. I was shocked that Montreal didn't just empty out and come out here to protest what was going on. I really thought everybody should take a week's vacation if they wanted to hold on to their job and get out here and say, this is enough, stop it. And I was really disappointed. Francois kept coming out with busloads of people over and over and over throughout the time. And but I expected pretty much the city to empty out and come out here, and they didn't. So that was a big disappointment. But then as armored vehicles showed up and the army entered, and helicopters flew over Tulo, these all had grave human consequences. And it was trauma that, being in the region, you felt on a visceral level. You were in it. You were coming upon an armored vehicle. I swear I saw tanks. The army says no. Now, when we look at heat maps of this whole region of Quebec, we can see that this is one of the few areas that isn't really a hot spot, hasn't been so degraded that it is contributing to solar, contributing to global warming. And there are a few in Quebec. Kahnawà looks good too when you look at a heat map. You can see that these areas have been protected. And so we're looking now to see, people began to think maybe there could be a different kind of future. Maybe we could think collectively about protecting culture and having environmental security, having safe places to live for everybody. And we know we don't really have to put asphalt and cement on every inch of the surface of the earth. We do not have to extract every speck of mineral. And we don't have to cut down every tree. We have the brains, we have the know-how to have a coordinated way of developing, surviving, but also respecting nature and wind. We know that the environment, we cannot continue to let development run amok. It's wiping out species and thousands of human beings. And we know in our heart of hearts, we knew in our heart of hearts that we could do these positive things, but the crisis brought these issues to the fore and brought people together to see the issues together. We know we have these abilities, and we know that this kind of future is within our grasp. Nyawa Goa.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you very much. And Elizabeth is like one of the very many examples of life after the crisis, of her support. And Elizabeth and I worked on some video projects. We did curriculum for the Mohawk Immersion School, and Elizabeth was a professor at Concordia University. So we're very happy to have you with us, Elizabeth. Thank you very, very much. And I would like to ask questions to my co-facilitator, because you are also going to have a piece in Onehkwéntara Kanehstóte, the Red Post exhibit. Could you talk about your piece and what you think some of those impacts have been on culture and advocacy?
Okay. Nyawa Ellen. So I was, as we were going through this discussion, there are so many dimensions of this experience that need to be addressed. And so one can ask the question, why art? Why do you think art has been a critical part of this discussion? And I think that I want to pull back for a second and just talk about why we need to insert this into this really important moment. And the space of, and I think that Kahnawà and all of the artists have created a vital way in which we are, in a sense, remaking or continue to make our experiences as indigenous people. And I get a little my own gadgets, and so so the question of can we make something that's actually more powerful, equally powerful, or equally significant to the actual event? And I think that this is really something that's important to consider. And so in bringing together these kind of thoughtful meditations, because each artwork that all of the artists that are contributing is in fact an experience and a meditation on a moment and experience. And to bring these forward then expands the dimension of what this experience has been, not just for the people that actually lived through it, but that it's profound that this moment impacted so many of us in so many different ways. And so for artists to be moved to respond to something, I think is what we're trying to capture or witness with the exhibit, that it begins to really point to the magnitude of what this moment meant in our lives as indigenous peoples. And that the art is this confirmation of what we went through, even though many of us weren't physically on the line, mm-hmm. or we weren't physically here. But as a Haudenosaunee woman, as a Tuscarora woman, one of the things that I experienced with this moment is that our communities at large had just been through a civil war that we've yet to really understand and digest. And so on our end, on the Western door, which is really the responsibility of the Seneca, the people on our end of the Confederacy were watching very closely what was happening here, and delegations from people in our communities came here. But at the same period of time, because Tuscarora is located near one of the largest hydroelectric projects in North America, people in our communities in solidarity were ready to take down the electric, the entire East Coast electric system in order to support Oka. And so there was a militaristic presence in our community when this happened. Our community was physically shut down. You couldn't come in and out of our territory. And since we're a border community like yours, we constantly deal with border patrol, both driving through our community as well as air in the air. And so there was definitely like a physical presence of attack that was going on at the same time that you were experiencing this here. And so, and this is just a minor point in, I think, the bigger realm of things, but that we have yet to, I think, fully assess not only what this moment meant for indigenous peoples, not only in North America, but globally. And I think that Clifford mentioned, you know, here he is in another part of the world and it comes up, and that's been my experience as well, that when I was in New Zealand or when I was in Australia, I always meet people that there are touchstone experiences. And so in one way, it is about the outreach of media, but at the same time, that, you know, this moment, whether it's indigenous or not, represented that flashpoint of what happened when a militaristic state is not checked. And so this is what we're witnessing, and I think what a number of the pieces are dealing with in the exhibit. And so my work is about the dialogue from the Eastern Door to the Western Door, and how, as a Confederacy, we imagine ourselves and then experience ourselves as Haudenosaunee in a colonial settler state. And so this is something that, you know, I think it's difficult for people to understand why we feel so strongly about our right to exist within our own cosmology, our own epistemological space, our own intellectual, historical understanding of how we exist in this world. That's what we are, that's what we are asserting. And artists, people that create things, tend to both affirm and innovate on what we feel. It's very difficult then to share feelings. And so art becomes a way that we can share these experiences. It becomes that touchstone that we can then experience something that we otherwise couldn't experience. So I guess Ellen and I have been having an ongoing, I see it sometimes as an ongoing Eastern Door, Western Door discussion. We are cousins in a way, in our traditional way, because we're both Turtle Clan, and it's a life journey for us that doesn't just start with this, but it's been going on for a while now, where we kind of looked at each other. I viewed us as looking at each other across the Confederacy and seeing another woman who was struggling in her own community, who was trying to find her voice and her place in the larger politic of indigenous space, and then having to encounter, having to like take up something that happened. You didn't ask for this. And so that's the other thing. It's that art becomes a way that I think many of us in some way fantasize or feel that we can assert control, because our lives as indigenous people, so much of our lives as indigenous people is that we're reacting to rather than controlling. And so I think that when we see these statements that you're making and that I think you're making, it's that it's our mechanism, it's our way of continuing to insinuate control in our lives. But, you know, in this discussion, I just want to reaffirm that we are not alone as indigenous peoples up against a militaristic state. Mm-hmm. I think that this is now a condition, and I have to think about this some more, but I really feel that the Oka Crisis represents that pivot point where maybe some people woke up and said, oh, on both sides of it, we're all in a militaristic state. Mm-hmm. And how did this happen? Mm-hmm. And how are we citizens in that place? Because if we can't speak in that space, and the immediate response to whatever it is we're thinking is violence, I mean, this is what we inherit. And so so that's, I guess, what motivated me to say that I feel that there is a critical role for makers, for people who imagine, to place their imaginary in conjunction or relationship to the so-called real, right? Because we can change the real through the imagined. And that's the role I accord to the artists and the songwriters and the dancers and the people out playing lacrosse and all of the actions that we can take. We can shift that dial. But if we only ever let this constructed real be the only way that we enact in this world, I feel that we really have then let go of the
and I think that's why art is such an important tool in our defense of our rights, of our struggles. An elder who was a residential school survivor came up to me, and she had seen Joan Cardinal Schubert's piece where there are desks and there are apples on top of that desk. And when she said she walked into that room, she had chills because she felt like she was back in the residential school. But she says it was an important piece, and she said the artists will lead the way for our healing. And so it's really interesting for me to see that from an elder. She wasn't an artist. She really, you know, not the way some people understand art, but it's how do we make that art accessible to our people. And I think that's what we're going to be trying to do with our show. Picasso did it with Guernica and the Spanish Civil War. There's been lots and lots of art since that time. And so I hope people will come to Kanehsatà and see this show starting August 1st in Kanehsatà. We're the ones on the golf course right now, not the bridge, but the golf course. It's a great honor and pleasure to work with you, Jolene. It's great to have a Tuscarora sister on the other side, you know, working on in parallel to this. So thank you very, very much, and thank you to the artists who came here. And you'll be able to see all their wonderful work. I'm doing also a piece. It's the Red Post, I just graduated from Concordia University in May 1990. The second all my final reports and final exams were done in April, I was on the barricades. I think it was in March, actually. So to me, I grew up in the Pines. The Pines is my refuge, my healing. My father had a riding school. We rented horses in the Pines. All those trails that were being used, you know, by the warriors. That was the trails from my dad's horses, and we had picnics. I mean, right now there's an event going on in the Pines, but the community had picnics. This golf course used to be grazing where our cows, you know, the community's cows would graze, and people would pick berries and all kinds of medicines where this golf course is right now. But if we're going to move forward, I think there are certain things we need to concede. We've got to stop the development that's going on with condominiums. We've got to stop this guy who's buying up land all around Oka Kanehsatà, who has all kinds of development plans. And we just have to bring that reconciliation to the forefront, as the Truth and Reconciliation has done. You know, it's about education. A lot of their recommendations are about education, and that's what we need. So thank you all for this. I'm going to move now to a different part of the program. I'm going to start first with François Saillant, who was part of a group of activists in Montreal protesting in front of Robert Bourassa's office, what, almost every single day? Almost every single day. And I think, you know, if it wasn't for the Quebecois people whose kindness and generosity and who said, you know, we have to respect Indigenous people's sovereignty before we start talking about ours, we're really leading the way and really bringing some hope and inspiration to people like myself, to people who were actually on the front lines. So François, thank you for coming from Montreal and to be part of this. And what prompted you to organize these protests? What prompted you to support the people and create La Solidarité avec les Autochtones?
I'd like to say first that I'm very proud to be here. Nairwan for the invitation. We have organized almost 25 actions during the summer of 1990. Some were demonstrations in Montreal in front of the Prime Minister's office. Robert Bourassa was the Prime Minister at the time. We have organized tens of demonstrations there. We have organized also direct action, public meeting, demonstrations in at Saint-Benoît, the temporary military bases that was very near Kanehsatà, on the traditional territory of Kanehsatà. We had a demonstration too in Kahnawà after the barricades were lifted, and after September the 26th, the arrest of the people of the that were at the treatment center. We had a demonstration at Farnham at the military bases. For us, it was very, very important to show that there were Quebecers that support the rights of the Mohawk people, and also disagree profoundly with the actions of the governments, both government, federal and provincial government, with the decision of the mayor of Oka and the municipal council of Oka, that disagree too with the media coverage, the big media, mass media coverage. It's always so ugly. Against this week, they said a lot of things that were absolutely false, but they continue to say that. It was important to show that we disagree with the racism of a part of the population. We knew for sure at that time that we were a little minority. We were very aware of that, and it was the reason why it was so important to be active and to be very, very noisy too. It was important, and we had the chance to have some people that were involved, some great women and men that were very known in Quebec. I'm thinking about the late Madeleine Parent, Léa Robach, Michel Chartrand, Pierre Vallière were very, very involved with us at the time, and also people that are still with us. And I'm thinking about Rémi Savard, who is just behind me, a very known anthropologist and writer in Quebec. All these people were involved in that, this demonstration. And for us, it was very, very important to do so. But I have to say that there's still a lot of work to do. I think that the fight that the Mohawks have led at the time has give a lot of give a big push, a big boost to the native awareness, with native consciousness all across Canada and even in the world. But the problems are still there. There's so little that has changed in the government's attitude, in the policeman attitude, in the media attitude, and the population attitude. So there's still a lot to do. Colonialism is still there. Racism is still there too. So. And there is also big issues. There is great danger for the lands, the natives' land, but also for the air, for the water. There's all these pipelines that they want to have and to go across your territory and the place where we live too. And I think that we have a lot of fights we have a lot to do. We have to work together against that, but to do so, to work together, I think that we have to have mutual knowledge, mutual respect, and we have to do a lot have the recognition of the rights of the native people, the recognition of their right to decide by themselves what is good for them. We have to respect the sovereignty of the First Nation. For me, it's a condition. I think that what we have said at the time is still true today. We have to have peace between our peoples, but to have peace, we have to have respect, we have to have freedom, and we have to have justice. For me, there's no peace, no justice, no peace, that's for sure.
And solidarité avec les autochtones has been very instrumental in educating the Quebecois public. You were there at the courthouse every day. When the people from the treatment center were being tried, you supported me when I was being charged with contempt of court by the coroner, and you had this wonderful newsletter in English and French. So I think we owe you from Kanehsatà a debt of gratitude for all the work that you've done. So thank you very, very much. And I hope we can show your film during the art show. François and his group have done a very powerful piece called Au-delà honte.
Au-delà de la honte. Behind shame.
Behind shame. So I posted it on my Facebook timeline. It's a very powerful piece, and it has a lot of the people, the well-known Quebecois leaders, talking about the crisis during that time. So thank you very, very much, François, for being here and sharing your story with us.
Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. After the crisis was a standing committee on investigating what was going on here during 1990. From the standing committee, we recommended a Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, which the standing committee took and recommended to the Government of Canada. The Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, I think there's 6 volumes of recommendations and stories, and we learned about the Indian residential schools, all those stories. I mean, we knew about them, but it became more to the forefront. From the Indian residential school and the Royal Commission, we had the negotiated Indian residential school settlement and the negotiated apology that Stephen Harper gave in Parliament, which was also part of the negotiated settlement, which lets you know that it wasn't a sincere apology. So from that we have the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and so we see the impacts at a different level that provides human rights advocates with the kind of ammunition that is needed to protect and promote the rights of Indigenous people. And in 2007, September 13th, we had the UN, the United Nations rights on the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. And with me today, I'm so proud and I'm so happy, are two people who actually worked on negotiating the settlement, the declaration, the draft of the declaration, were present when the UN General Assembly passed it. So it's a great honor to have Paul Joff and Jennifer Preston here. So I want to ask you a couple of questions. And the first one is, what are the advances in the international human rights system for Indigenous people? So Paul, if you'd like to, or Jennifer, whoever wants to go first.
We always operate as a tag team, and for some reason, I always go first. it works for both of us. Well, thank you, Ellen, for having us here, and it's a great honor for us also to be here with you. We are going to talk about a few things, and we wanted to start at the international level and to start with the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, because Ellen and I have had conversations over quite a lot of time over, you know, where are we in a different place from 25 years ago. And of course, one of the very important and dramatic advances in the international human rights system as a whole, and also for Indigenous peoples globally, was the adoption of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. I have a booklet copy. It's pretty small to be seeing from your space, but which was adopted in 2007, as Ellen said, after more than 20 years of negotiations. And those negotiations were Indigenous peoples. Many people, like the people who started our speaking this morning, people who came from their communities from all over the world, and what they came to the UN, and what they did is they told their stories. And they said, this is what's happening where we are. This is our story. This is our struggle. And it was out of those stories that the instrument was crafted, which makes it for unique in the international human rights system that it was the first instrument that was designed with the beneficiaries, with the rights holders that helped to create it. And it was also, because it was developed over a period of more than 20 years, also makes it the most discussed instrument in the history of the UN. And so one of the differences is, I mean, this was actually under negotiations in 1990 while this was happening in Geneva. But it shows also where the world was moving to. The world had Indigenous peoples went to the UN because they knew they weren't getting justice in their homelands. And they went to the UN because they thought, if we can't make justice happen at our domestic level, we have to go to the international level. And in fact, the first time that I went, one of the things that I thought was, I was listening to those stories and I thought, there will never be a declaration because Indigenous people have come here with these stories, their individual stories, and state representatives have come with a mandate from their capital, which is a huge disconnect. But it did happen, and it happened because of the work and the commitment both by Indigenous and also by government representatives from around the world. So it did happen. And so, you know, it's a tremendous thing, and it's a tremendous achievement, and it's a tremendous tool for Indigenous peoples all over the world to be using. And Ellen, I know, and we can maybe talk about that a little later, translated it so that it also has to be available to people. It's not just an international instrument to be used by people who are working at the international level, but it's also an instrument for people to use in their communities and in their education systems. And Ellen mentioned the TRC, and the main recommendation of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission is that the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples is a framework for reconciliation. So this is a place where, you know, the individual struggles come together into moving forward. But in addition, since the time of the crisis, in addition to the adoption of the UN Declaration, we also now at the UN have three different mechanisms that are specifically devoted to the rights of Indigenous peoples. There's a special rapporteur, which is like a global expert that's appointed in official capacity to carry out a mandate respecting the rights of Indigenous peoples and investigating violations when Indigenous peoples' violations happen. There is two different bodies, one that's housed in New York, one that's housed in Geneva, that address Indigenous peoples' rights. We have in New York, we have the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, which is one of the places where Ellen and I met. And we also in Geneva have the UN Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which is a standard-setting process for Indigenous peoples' human rights moving forward. This also, having all of these mechanisms, is an expression by the international community that Indigenous peoples' rights, A, went through a period of many decades of international work where they weren't being taken into account, and now recognizing the importance of that work and the importance of engaging in that work. So that's a real shift. We were not in that place 25 years ago. Now having three mechanisms and having a UN declaration, having an Indigenous people negotiations, at the sustainable development negotiations, you know, at the when they're negotiating different instruments, whether it's dealing with women's rights or the Disability Convention, Indigenous peoples are always now part of that dialogue. So there's been a huge shift internationally. Paul will speak then a little bit more about some of those other specific pieces.
Can I ask you, in light of the obvious extreme failings of the state 25 years ago, what are relevant important human rights advances in Canada for Indigenous peoples?
Well,
this is Paul Jaffe.
Yeah, I'm Paul Jaffe, a lawyer based in Montreal and working with Indigenous peoples. Well, I think the biggest difference always is when Indigenous peoples get involved. So when you had, for example, even in 1982, the Aboriginal and treaty rights put into the Constitution, that would never have happened if Indigenous voices didn't make sure that they were heard and that they continued to press for it. Otherwise, it would have been a continuation of exclusion. It's the same thing at the international level. You can have international human rights instruments. You can even have, like, in the International Covenants on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights and International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, it says that all peoples have the right of self-determination, all peoples, but yet they wouldn't apply, states in their own countries wouldn't apply that provision, even though they ratified those conventions. They wouldn't apply it to Indigenous peoples. But when Indigenous peoples got involved, they made sure that that became part of the dialogue and part of the framework. And that's the only way you'll succeed in the future. Human rights are a great thing, but it's wrong when you have a history of human rights violations, and then when you raise your human rights, they don't want to include them. So there's no question about the advancements in Canada. Alan mentioned the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Again, if Indigenous peoples weren't involved, you would get a very different report. And you would never hear about cultural genocide or even genocide. And so this is the only way to bring a reality. And I would like to just say that I noticed there's one thing that's similar between the art world and what we do, and that's a big statement to make. We both deal, if I listened carefully and understood, you're dealing with fear and ignorance and bias. And the art world can open that up in many different ways and make people reflect in ways often that aren't threatening. And in human rights, those are the same three elements. We were told by one of the federal officials, who for years he was one of the terrors in the government, but in the later years he became an ally, and he said the biggest thing you have that you have to overcome is fear among the states, but it's also ignorance and bias, and the only way that can change is if Indigenous peoples make sure that your perspectives, your values, your priorities, and your rights are involved.
Can you describe some of for us some of the developments that we can identify with locally, advances for human rights defenders and environmental defenders?
One of the things that we talk about, and you know, we've been, Ellen has brought Paul and I into, I think, two or three times to do workshops on the Declaration and how the work in the Declaration can be used at the local level, is that international work doesn't have any effect if it's only in a library. And it has to have meaning on the ground. So, of course, all of the work in the Declaration has to be translated in how are we using it locally. And that's, you know, a part of that was the translation into Mohawk. And it's, you know, it has to be meaningful to people in their own space and how it's important to them. And I think that you also see that in the TRC, and I think in the work of the TRC. And when you talk about local work and you talk, like, what is reconciliation? It's a big word. And, you know, here we're sitting on the lawn of the Oka Golf Course. Like, who would have thought? And so here we are. Here we are. What an interesting group of people sitting on the lawn of the Oka Golf Course.
We were sitting on the lawn of the Oka Golf Course 25 years ago, but not in the same circumstances.
Yeah, the circumstances were different. And so I think that's fascinating. And I think on the local level, like, that is reconciliation. But I also think, and I really liked, I think maybe Wanda who brought it up, was the idea of the, you know, a settler syndrome. We have to, on a global level and certainly on a Canadian level, you know, people have to move past denial. Canada is a modern nation state that was founded on theft and fraud. Everyone has to accept that that is the starting point of the modern nation state of Canada. And if you can't, if we can't accept that, we will never arrive at reconciliation. So we don't have to be stuck in, oh, I need to feel guilty about theft and fraud. What we have to do is say, okay, so now what am I doing with that? And so what is reconciliation? Reconciliation includes redress. Redress, you know, is often about land rights. And, you know, what? How did this story begin? You know, it began about the land. So I think all of those pieces tie together, and the local work ties to the national work, and it all, and ties to the international work, and it's all interconnected. And I think that, you know, it's about relationships, and it's about... it's about partnerships, and it's about relationships, and it's about learning, you know, to understand where different people are coming from and to find that place where you meet. You know, what is our shared future? You know, that's a story to be explored. And so, but I think that it is, there is that settler syndrome of denial. It's something that people have to be able to embrace it and let it go. Because if you try to pretend it doesn't exist, we're not moving forward. Mm-hmm. So we have to be able to acknowledge it. I think that one of the things that's happening that's profoundly important that was happening locally, nationally, internationally, is that there's faith groups across the country, partly in response to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, that are working on national statements to repudiate the doctrine of discovery. Now, the doctrine of discovery comes from hundreds of years ago when the church decided that they could take land in the New World in the name of their sovereign because indigenous peoples weren't really people. So if they're not people, then we get to take their land because they're not really humans. So, you know, now that we're in a place in 2015 where churches across this country are saying, we're all issuing statements saying, you know, that it's totally racist, it's totally discriminatory, we totally disassociate. But those were the attitudes that did begin the founding of the nation state of Canada. So moving forward out of those ideas and people learning the history is what we have to do. For that. And I think that also Paul's going to speak to, because I think it's really important across the country as well, is the decision that came out of the Supreme Court of Canada last year, the Chakotay Nation case, which is also a land case. So I'm going to give the microphone back to him to talk about that.
Thank you. Yeah, the Chakotay Nation decision by the Supreme Court came out last June. And what's interesting is the federal government has never made an official statement on it. They'd rather ignore it. They were terribly defeated in that case, but they will not speak to it. And even there was recently a comprehensive claims person, special representative of the minister, who had to go around the country and get views of indigenous peoples, amongst others. And even he said that when he went, he was appointed by the Indian Affairs Minister, yet when he went to the federal government, no civil servant was allowed to speak on the Chilcotin Nation case. And again, that's fear. They know how powerful it may be, and they don't wish to even engage. The Chilcotin Nation case is very significant because it's the first time in history that the Supreme Court of Canada has recognized Aboriginal title to Indigenous lands, territories, and resources. And why it's so far-reaching as well is that the court said that if you have Aboriginal title, the state, the Crown, whether it's federal, provincial, does not have any beneficial interest, which means that they don't have any right to the land, the resources, or that territory. And the government tried to argue, both BC and the feds, that Well, if there is tidal, it's only little spots like the rock they fished on, you know, things like that. And the court said, of course, that that's not true. It is a territorial base. And so they affirmed that it can be a vast amount of territory. So this, it opens it up for the future. The court didn't get into governance or indigenous governments, really. But what they said, the way they described tidal, they used the words that suggest that the only way you could exercise those rights is really, effectively, that is through your governments. And if that's the case, and because it was a constitutional case, it means that there aren't two orders of government in the Canadian Constitution. There aren't just federal and provincial governments. There are Indigenous governments. There are three orders. That changes the whole balance and how you cooperate. And there has to be more cooperation. But cooperation based on your rights, based on your status, and based on your governments. In other words, based from a position of strength. And that's what the Chilcotin Nation can bring, that case. Now, no case alone can do it all. But this is a tremendous advancement. And so one can build, in a more principled way, a framework in the future. So if you combine some of these advances at the Supreme Court level with the international level, such as the UN Declaration, you can use the Declaration and other international human rights instruments to even further reinforce your own positions. Now, I should say that the Declaration, it says that Indigenous peoples have the right to be different, to be considered different and respected as such. So that you as Mohawks, or someone else as, well, it could be Tuscarora, it could be Abenaki, it could be Cree, whatever, can interpret the Declaration from your own perspective. You don't have to take a non-Native perspective, and you don't have to take another Indigenous nation perspective. You can interpret it from your own perspective. And so that gives you a very broad way to ensure that your cultures and priorities are given the most weight.
Well, thank you very, very much, Paul. It's a great honor to have you with us, because you have done such great work at the international level and continue to teach me and I know others. We always learn from you. And Jennifer, thank you very, very much. The Quakers have been very supportive of us over the 20th anniversary, provide food for people, but also to help us do the declaration translation in Kanyakeha. It's that kind of support that we need, and sometimes another perspective from outside the community is always gives us an extra push to say, we're on the right track. So I want to offer up, if Jolene has any questions for our two panelists here, we're talking about the international level.
Yes. So last year we were all at the World Conference for Indigenous Peoples at the UN. And I think we all know that there was presidents and significant representation from various countries in the world, with the exception, of course, of the United States. Mm-hmm. The United States sent a very low-level media spokesperson to address the assembly. And so I think that in what Indigenous peoples in the Americas are struggling with is that there's a very different progress and movement in Canada than there is in the United States. And so what do you think in the Canadian government has made a difference to move to a discourse of reconciliation, which has not occurred in the United States as it relates to Indigenous peoples? There's never been this lack of awareness or recognition, I think, is ongoing. And so how do you view this from the perspective that you're in? because I think that one of the things that we're looking at is that my presence here reinforces the idea that as Haudenosaunee people, we have a territory that the more recent settler states have divided. Mm-hmm. And so we have to continue to educate ourselves and our children that we have to understand both systems in order to navigate this experience. And so that's where I'm hoping you can provide some context in the how you're looking at what goes on in the states.
It's interesting. Canada and the U.S. are the two nation states of the entire global community that were the last to come on board with the UN Declaration. And when the UN Declaration was adopted, there was only four countries in the world that opposed it, and they were Canada and the U.S. and Australia and New Zealand. And Australia and New Zealand pretty quickly had changes of government, who then reversed their position. And then we had the election of Barack Obama. So at that point in time, everyone knew that what was coming was that Obama was going to support the declaration. And Canada really didn't want to be the last country in the world, the only country in the world that was opposed to this human rights declaration. And so Canada, you know, begrudgingly posted a press release on a Friday afternoon at 3 o'clock saying, well, you know, we guess we can go with it. And Barack Obama did a little better than that, because he actually did it in he made his endorsement a little more of a ceremony. Canada and the U.S. are very troublesome states, and one of the things that we've done here and in our work and work that Ellen does, and we work with many other colleagues across the country, all across the country, is that we've worked together. We have an informal group that's a coalition. Coalition for the Human Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and in that coalition, the work that we've done has been to raise awareness and to also bring people together to know, because we're stronger in coalition. And we came together during the development of the declaration, and it was because we recognized that in Canada, the Canadian government was one of the big problems for a lot of years in the development of the declaration. But when we came together as a group to work with each other, we were able to put a lot of effective pressure on the Canadian government. And so that unity with Indigenous leadership, Indigenous communities, human rights organizations, that unity that we had with each other was very effective. And so we've stayed together as a group doing educational work around raising awareness on the declaration, which I also think is really important. The educational work, human rights education, is critical. And everyone is doing, I mean, human rights education is lifelong. But that is, you know, that's where change comes from. Education is the key. And I think that, you know, for the work that we do, the joint work we do, when we work, you know, at the community level with people like Ellen, or if we're working at the national level with national organizations or regional political bodies, all of that is about educational work. And it's about learning, you know, learning what our rights, what are human rights, how do we respect human rights. And that's all that journey for everyone to be on. And I think the reason that we have had success in the work that we've done as a group in Canada has also been because we've worked with each other, because we're a broad coalition of partners, often supported by unions, you know, by civil society groups. It's often the case. So, but that also is that lawmakers respond to pressure when they know it's coming in numbers. And so I think that when people are united and the voices are strong enough, then they can't be ignored quite so easily. So finding the place where there can be, where people can come to, people are always going to have differences and we respect each other's differences, but finding the place where we can come together is a position of strength. You want to add to that?
Yeah. We have heard the same concern that you're bringing up from other U.S. people, Indigenous people located in the U.S., that how come there isn't the same amount of activism in terms of these issues? And Jennifer is right. The best way is to start building broader coalitions of those who are like-minded in thought. It doesn't mean everyone has to have the exact same position, but it just has to be a coalition where people realize that the adversaries are outside, not amongst. And there can always be political differences or differences in position, but you start building it. And in our meetings of that coalition across Canada, it isn't very political. There's hardly any internal politics. When we get together to meet, it's on substance. And we figure out who's going to do what. And different organizations or people contribute to creating that collective position.
Well, let me just interject that just a question of meeting. So in the United States, the arts have been so defunded that it's almost impossible for artists to meet across different communities. And the next site of assault, I think, is on the humanities when you bring up education. And so there's a real withdrawal from educating the citizenry of the United States around these broader human rights-based themes and redirecting education towards the technological paradigm. And so I do think there are structural differences that need to be overcome in order to facilitate this discussion. And so at one point in time, there was actually funding in the United States for artists to come together, and that was in the heyday of the 1980s. And you can definitely see a difference between the coalitions across different constituencies that existed that are really not in place today. And so I understand what you're saying, but the levels of governmental support actually, or opportunities here in Canada, do seem to be a little more available than what we're dealing with, I think, across the river. But that's, you know, something just to overcome, I would say, not to stop us.
I think just like most discussions that have to deal with such deep realities, there are many offshoots, just as there are many stories of about the crisis, about human rights. And I want to give a chance for all our panelists to have a very quick word. What do you see as the vision for the future? So if you can say it in a minute, 30 seconds would be better. Like, what is it we need to move forward? What are we going to need? What are we going to need to bring the kind of justice, the kind of peaceful coexistence that we were looking for, that we tried to do, we continue to try to do in our communities? So think about it. We're going to start on this side with Elizabeth Saka, because she put her hand up. And I just want to say, you know, this webinar is possible because of Idle No More. And the great communication team that has been putting this together. Hi, Anna, who is also on the other end of this, of the computer, webcasting to hundreds of, hopefully thousands, would be nice, of millions. Spence, for his wonderful knowledge, and technician, to Andre Richard from this community, Jaggy Singh and Q Perg for donating their soundboard, Parker. These are the guys behind the scenes that are making us look all really good. So let's go around, one round for all the participants, and then we're going to have a song.
I would just follow up on what Paul is saying. It seems to me that the skills required to meet and to collaborate on substance are hard to come by. It takes learning. One has to be in a group, see people function that way, learn these skills, and I would say the learning the skills to come together from different perspectives, different politics, and putting politics aside, which I'm very political, but I can do this. But I'd like to see more generalized or more people getting together to develop this collectively, and I think perhaps the arts could take the lead in that.
Thank you, Elizabeth Sucka. This is Wanda Gabriel.
Sego. So, in a short message, oppression embeds within human relations three basic rules, and they are don't talk, don't trust, and don't feel. So for me, to continue reconciliation, to continue healing, we have to break those rules. We have to break the rules of oppression, of don't talk, don't trust, and don't feel. We need to take a risk to sit down with the other and to talk about what I feel, to share my feelings. I have to take a risk to trust, and we have to break the silence on what oppression is doing to our country. Tano.
What I'm seeing with our young people would really need to instill the cultural identity back into our youth. And yes, they are nowadays, most of them, proud to be Mohawk, but what does that mean? Give them a very good understanding of who they are, where they come from, and where they're going. And that way, they could also be able to work with the outside communities and have a respect for them, as well as teach the other communities to have respect for us. And I think that comes from having a strong base, a strong cultural identity with our youth, and it'll carry us into the future.
I think Ellen's asked a really difficult question. And I'm wondering if the people that are live streaming, have answers, because I don't have an answer that I think goes beyond the ideas that are expressed. I agree with Elizabeth that I think the arts will lead, and it's because of that imaginative space, the reimagining that's going on. And just in response to Paul, I think that law is also an imagining, and that the kind of law that I hope that we can come to is actually a law that becomes part of perhaps the heritage that we come from, which is thinking about something people have called natural law, which the core principle is to seek peace. And so I think what these events teach us is that peace is difficult. It's not an easy thing to achieve, but we have to. Yawa.
Yeah, these are some great thoughts, very powerful. I think in terms of collaboration, I'll just mention three qualities, I guess, three elements. We should always, I think, be sure never to leave behind those that may have the least, or be in a position where they feel the least powerful, because in our own collaborations, we've, even when it's global, we've gone to reach out to those who have the least resources financially or human, or maybe facing the most oppression, and helping to make sure they're included and that their voices are heard from their point of view. And then what you said, Wanda, of course, is critical. The other thing I would mention is, in terms of human rights education, which a number of people have mentioned, of course one has to bring in the youth, one has to bring in perspectives of women and girls, one has to bring in elders. In other words, it's got to be really democratic and broad. And if one practices it amongst ourselves, then it's going to go much further than if we're sort of more limited in our scope.
I had a unique childhood in that I spent a lot of my young time in northern Quebec, in what's now northern Quebec and northern James Bay, among the Cree, because that's where my parents were at that time. And that made me different from kids that I went to school with, because when I went to school, the history book said that Canada, you know, Canada started when the English and French arrived here. That's what they said when I went to school. So my childhood was very different from that. And then when my daughter was a young child, I took her with me when I traveled for work. One time when she was about 7, and we were in a small Mi'kmaq community in New Brunswick, and we were visiting there. We were staying with a Mi'kmaq family for several days. And when we came back, her grade 2 teacher said to her, you know, what was it like there? Like, she wanted her to tell the other students in her classroom, what was different there than in your community? And she said, my daughter was 7. She stopped and she's trying to think what's different. She didn't see that it was dirt roads. She didn't see that. She didn't see how many people lived in the house that we were staying in. But she said, oh, my friend, because there was a daughter that was the same age. They were actually born the same day. They were exactly the same age. She said, my friend's grandmother lives in the house next door to her, and her uncle lives in the house next door to her. And that's what a 7-year-old saw as the difference between her community and their community. And so I think that going forward, is what I see is that our education changes enough so that we understand, you know, both where we came from, but also where we're going and the importance in those places.
Quebecers want their national rights to be recognized and part of it, but for that they have to recognize too the rights of the indigenous people. They have to recognize their sovereignty, their territories, and we have to work ourselves to protect the land, to protect the natural resources. We have a lot of fights to get together, but for that we have to recognize the rights.
Well, for myself, my next thing that I'm going to be imagining for peace is money, meaning how can we go past capitalism? I think a lot of people think of capitalism like gravity, like it's a fact, but of course it's actually made by humans. It's our minds that are capitalized. Capitalismed. So that's my next thing. I think that could go a long way towards peace. And then, of course, the other bigger, more important thing is love. We just have to remember love. We have to remember how important it is, how beautiful it is, and how we have to let it happen where it needs to happen. That's it.
I think I'm going to add to what you said and say communication. It's the reason why I choose to do art, is that I find it the way to communicate ideas, to offer a different perspective. As has been mentioned here, I think it's really important, a way to open up doors to be able to see things, permit people to see things from in a different way and learn about things, education.
Thank you. I think that public education is the key. And all Quebecers are not proud of what they learn after the Oka Crisis, what we learn about Aboriginal peoples. If you give them the possibility to hear other things, they will... And I saw that with the success of my book, Aboriginal Peoples, Fact and Fiction, Matérialité sur les peuples autochtones, that I published at the Human Rights Commission. And this is a success. And I met... and my two sons are around 30 years old. They learn nothing at the school, but my younger, my daughter, who is 20 years old, is an enfant de la réforme, and she learned at the primary level many things about Aboriginal peoples. You ask to a group of young, how many nations in Quebec? Oh, 11. hey, they know now. And the same thing. At the secondary level, she learned about indigenous territories. This is new in all schools in Quebec now, and I think there is great hope on this side.
Thank you, Pierre. Thank you to Idle No More. A shout out to Sheila McLean, who's hopefully she's watching, and she helped make this possible. So thank you to Sheila McLean, and to Spence, to Anna, Jaggy, Parker, our team behind the scenes, and this young Madeline. Thank you to Jolene Rickard, Elizabeth Saka, Wanda Gabriel, Julie Gaspi, Paul Joff, Jennifer Preston, François Sayan, Scawanati, Hannah Claus, and Pierre Lepage, and to our guests who left, Clifton Nicholas and Francine Lemay. I can hear the marchers coming up the road. There is a march that's going on right now, which some of the people have organized. I don't know if we want to wait to cut our live stream until they pass by. But I want to shout out to all the people, and later if this is televised, thank you to the Oka Golf Club, to Kanehsatà Kehronu, who think that it is such a painful experience that you don't want to talk about it. Here's a discussion about it by people who are proud of what we did, who are proud to be in support of us. So, Pierre, you talked about your daughter learning about Indigenous people. In this community, the Oka Crisis is not even being taught, and we need to change. Those are some of the things. Peace, love, and respect, those are the things those are the things that we need to continue forward. Need to keep educating people, because as we know, people think it's all about the warriors, and it's not about them. I'm so sorry for those who think that it is. It's really about the land. It's really about the people who put their lives on the line, those who didn't have guns, those who were in the community living, those outside the community giving us food, protesting, supporting, and to the human rights advocates who have been doing, and to the artists who continue to make this in our memories and keep this strong, to our ancestors before us who fought very hard to keep this land, and Ungwawana, our language, Kanyakeha, and to all our Kanyakahaga ancestors. If you ever come to Kanehsatà, please do not visit our cemetery. It is not a tourism site. It is where our ancestors are buried. And please respect that site. It is very sacred to us because it's where our people are resting. I would like this to be the first of many dialogues to talk about what the impacts were, to talk about human rights, to talk about no pipelines, no Keystone XL, no Line 9B and 9, no to Enbridge, no to TransCanada, no to the Energy East. Those are the things that are uniting all of our people, whether they're in the U.S., whether they're in Canada, whether they're Indigenous or non-Indigenous. And so I am really amazed by the people who have talked with us here today. I don't know if there's images that are streaming, and how, you know, I'm going to rely on Spence to see what he thinks. Should just wait until the marchers pass by, but they're coming slowly but surely. We've had marches each almost major anniversaries. To our brothers and sisters in Kanehsatà, hope you're enjoying the powwow, and thank you again for supporting us here in Kanehsatà 25 years ago. I don't know who else to thank, but it's been a great journey. I hope it continues to be a great journey. Please come by August 1st here to the community of Kanehsatà to see the wonderful Onehkwéntara Kanehstóte, the Red Post Art Show. And please, if you're an educator, if you're a parent, if you're an auntie, if you're an uncle, a grandmother, a grandfather, make sure that this history is being told.
Ellen, maybe we could just have you explain the significance.
The Red Post is something that was done, was part of our customs of our people. And when our people went to war, they erected a Red Post in the middle of the community so that people who even were visitors would know that our people were at war. So Julie, I don't know if you want to, could you finish us and thank all our people, the I Don't Know More people, all our participants, all the people who are live streaming with a song, an honor song with our water drum. Nyawa Julie Gaspi.
Nyawa.
I think it would be appropriate to do the friendship dance.
Okay. So all the people in here will do the friendship dance.
Away ahead, way ahead, way ahead, way ahead, way ahead, oh yeah, away ahead, Yahweh ho, Yahweh ho, yo, away ahead. Away ahead, way ahead, way ahead, way ahead, way ahead, away ahead, Yahweh ho, Yahweh ho, yo.
Stand in the sun? Sitting like there. Yeah. You guys are awesome. And you're cute, too. Thank you. Great.
Thank you.